It is our custom to stand at home when we read the word of the Lord. Please indulge me one more time and stand. I'm reading from the Message Bible. So it's going to read slightly differently from either the King James, the New King James, or even the American Standard. The Message Bible is a contemporary reading of the text. So it's going to read slightly different. It's chapter 4, and we're going to read verses 13 through 17. Chapter 4 of the book of Esther, verses 13 through 17. Listen. When Hatcher told Mordecai what Esther had said, Mordecai sent her this message. Don't think that just because you live in the king's house, you're the one Jew who will get out of this alive. If you persist in staying silent at a time like this, help and deliverance will arise for the Jews from someplace else. But you and your family will be wiped out. Who knows? Maybe you were made queen for just such a time as this. Esther sent back her answer to Mordecai. Go and get all the Jews living in Susa together. Fast for me. Don't eat or drink for 3 days, either day or night. I and my maidens will fast with you. If you will do this, I'll go to the king, even though it's forbidden. If I die, Mordecai left and carried out Esther's instructions. I do see some Calvaryites here, so I'm glad to see you all. Thank you for sneaking away. I will never tell Pastor that you were here. Sometimes you come to church and you know, you just sit next to the wrong person for whatever reason. They have their own issues, their own concerns, you know, and they just come. I'm not sure why they come, but they just, you know, they have these kind of little issues or whatever. So sometimes you got to work it on the road. Say, work it on the road.
Work it on the road.
And that is, you have to make sure that your atmosphere and your environment is conducive to what God wants to do for you on today. As we wind down this 2013 women's season, we need to know that we're on the right track, that we're moving by faith forward. So you need to check out your role. You need to check out your role. Check out your role. You need to check out your role. You need to check out your role. You really need to check out your role. Because I'm gonna end this thing right. Tell your neighbor, I'm gonna end it right. I'm gonna end it. Now you can help me or I'll end it right without you help. Without you or your help. I'm gonna have myself a good time in here by here. Look at your neighbor and repeat after me. Say, neighbor.
This afternoon
co-pastor
is going to preach about
For such a time as this. And look at your neighbor on the other side and say, neighbor,
I will get the job done.
Sisters, throw your hands up in the air and wave them like you just don't care. And serve notice on Satan. Say, Satan, you gave it your best shot, and I'm still here because I am the woman for the job. Say it! Yes. Sit down. Let's work it out. Leave it. I'm the woman for the job. I approach the text with a little apprehension. I do approach it with a little apprehension because I do know that at women's services, be that retreats, symposiums, or conferences or worship services like we're involved in today, inevitably somebody's going to talk about either Ruth, Deborah, or Esther. So, in an effort not to be ordinary, I stayed away from their stories for a number of years. But here of late, the Lord has tweaked my heart through the Holy Spirit and caused me to revisit some of the well-known Bible sheroes. I suspect at least 90 to 95% of you somewhere in your tenure, your walk with the Lord, either through a teaching method or through a preaching method, especially the ladies, you have heard about this Esther saga. So it is not my intention to bore you with probably logistics that you already know. But what I've come to learn about the Holy Spirit is that he can take what we may consider to be familiar bread and give it a freshness heretofore. And it's with that premise that we're going to approach this well-known story. Let's begin by talking a little bit about the providence of God. Say the providence of God. That's God's ability to be totally in control. That even though life sometimes takes twists and turns that we have not expected or that we have not necessarily prepared for, God's providence keeps us through all kinds of situations. I've got a few sisters sitting up in here that if the mic were passed to them could testify along with me that God has kept me. It was not my education, it was not my family pedigree, it was not my social status, but it was God. I got some ladies up in here who know how to lean and depend on God. Now, when everyone else turns away and backs up, there is a group of us that have made up our mind, come hell or high water, I'm going to walk it with Jesus. I didn't start this journey with him to quit. So whatever I've got to deal with, I just deal with it. Because I have enmeshed myself in the word that says that God can deliver you from any and everybody. Unfortunately, those of us who believe like that are in the minority. Most people, Pastor Wesley, don't believe the Bible. It is evident in how you serve him, but I believe the Bible. Did you hear what I said? Didn't he tell you I was ghetto? Why we come from a church? Open your mouths. Do you believe what I said? Thank you. I believe the Bible. I believe every word of the Bible. I believe that God is a healer. No matter what the doctor has diagnosed, I believe that God is a healer. I believe that God is a deliverer. I don't care if you smoke coke till your brains have gone completely out. I believe the Bible, that God can deliver and restore. I believe that God can reconcile and bring good out of bad. I believe that he can rearrange and reconcile, restore, and cause what the enemy meant for evil to make it bless you. I believe the Bible.
I believe that the righteous will always triumph. And everything that the locusts, the plum worms, and the caterpillars have taken, I believe God can restore it in a day. I wish I had a piece of church. Put your pocketbooks down and relax, because you're going to clap your hands and you're going to celebrate. Believe the Bible. I do not believe that we ought to start this journey and then quit. I don't fool around with quitters, because you do not inspire me. And I need from time to time to be inspired. I don't fool around with people that always got something going wrong, ain't nothing ever going right. I don't know why it happened to me. Well, neither do I. But what I do know is that God can bring you out. Pastor Wesley, until I can talk about it, I'll shout it out. That's too deep for some of y'all, because y'all just sit there and take every beating the devil sends. You just brace yourself to be beat up and beat up and beat up. I braced myself to break him down, break him down, break him down. If he didn't take me out when I was in the world, he shone up. Y'all gonna make me say something. He shone up, blank, blank, ain't gonna take me out now. Please sit down. We're in introduction. Please sit down. It's the providence of God, his ability to be in control. But the other thing that I learned about God is that he's not so much in control that you have no control. He's not going to come down here and send an angel and shut up all the liquor stores so you stop drinking. Y'all gonna make me preach like I'm at home. I'm trying to be nice, y'all. I want y'all to invite me back, you know. He's not gonna take all the fine women out off the street so you can keep your pants zipped up. That's not gonna happen. Tell you what I told the other group. I ain't scared of nobody up in here. He not gonna remove all the tall, dark, and handsome men out of here so that you can behave yourself. You've got to make up your mind that you're gonna walk like God wants you to walk. And you go act like God wants you to act. What's missing in the church nowadays is core values. We don't have no core values. We say anything, and especially some of you women, you so disrespectful, somebody needs just to punch you out. How are you gonna go with somebody else's husband? That is pure disrespect. A little trash yourself. Let me calm down. That's for all y'all that thought y'all were gonna sleep on me. You won't sleep this one. Some control over what you do and what you say and how you act. If you're a Christian, then act like a Christian. We shouldn't have to guess who you are. And if you're only a Christian when you come to Alfred Street, in my mind, you're not a Christian at all. If you only can walk it in here, then I got problems with you. You ought to be able to walk it out there. So God does have providence. And God does give you some control. But what I have learned, Brother Joseph, is that what God does is, he since he is omniscient, like the sister said, since he knows everything, what he does do occasionally is he arranges certain situations in your life because he knows that eventually you will come to him. So he keeps you alive long enough for you to get yourself together. Aren't you glad that God did not take you out before you became a born-again believer? Some of y'all ought to praise him 24/7 that he kept you alive long enough for you to praise him as your Lord and Savior. I need some blood-washed, born-again believers of the cross to jump up and give God praise for saving your life. If he does nothing else for me, the fact that he saved me, brought me out of darkness into a marvelous light, says to me, I got to praise him the balance of my life. The fact that for 18 years I prayed for my daddy to walk into a church. I've been preaching for 18 years before my daddy heard me say anything. But if you stay with God and walk uprightly before him, he will give you the desires of your heart. The Lord saved my daddy at 64 from smoking, drinking, and chasing women. I ain't afraid to say it. At 64 years old, bless the name of Jesus, he turned my daddy's life around. I'm a daddy's girl, and I refuse to believe that when my father closed his eyes, he would open them in hell. At the age of 92, he took him, but he took him with his Bible in his coffin. If you walk it right, let's say it like the Bible says it. No good thing will I withhold from them that walk uprightly before me. But he arranges certain situations in certain people's lives because he knows what they were going and what they are going to do. Such then is the case of the text. He does not manipulate, but he does arrange. He does arrange. He lets things fall in a certain order so that his purpose and plans and destiny for your life can be achieved. Some women in here know something about destiny. When all the odds have been stacked up against you and nobody believed in you, you had to believe in yourself. I know what that feels like when nobody thinks anything good can come out of your life for whatever reason, because perhaps you didn't come from the best family in the city, or you didn't finish high school, you know, as if education is some prerequisite for the anointing. Matter of fact, there wasn't too many smart people that Jesus dealt with. It was the drug addicts and the alcoholics and the prostitutes that he found the most use for. Because when you have been at life's bottom, anybody that can help you get up, you'll appreciate them. That's why some women serve God harder than others. I enjoyed the little sister running and dancing. That's why I wanted to get up and give her a hand clap. Honey, don't let nobody stop you from praising God. People don't know what you go through. They will try to sum you up and add you up. You don't know nothing about me. So you do what you got to do. If you got to cross the road, cross the road. If you got to skip up the center aisle, skip up the center aisle. If you have to say excuse me and get in the aisle and just jump straight up and down, do what you got to do to keep yourself together. Because folk don't have heaven or hell, and people try to dredge you by how, you know, I'm just one of those quiet ones. I just sit quietly, and I just praise them in my spirit. Well, good for you. We're not going to bother you. You sit right there quietly and praise them in your spirit. But if I don't scream and holler, if I don't jump and shout, I ain't going to make it next week. Open up your mouth and give God a praise. Say! Please, take your seats. We haven't gotten to the points yet. You're not going to make me be quiet. I know there's a song that says, blessed quiet, that isn't all this. But I deal with people with real needs, and I don't have all the answers. But I do know if they give God praise and glory, eventually an answer will come. So, he doesn't manipulate, but he arranges. Such is the point of the text. Small number of characters are here. You have Mordecai. You have Esther, you have Haman, and they're living in Susa, a strange place. And here it is that God is going to do something extraordinaire. I came to help some sisters realize that everything that you have been through up until this time, God has orchestrated it for this now time. So find yourself another sister and say, sister, this, didn't I tell you, if I tell you one more time to talk loud, I'm gonna run down that aisle. Tell you one more time to talk loud. I said we talk loud. Find yourself a sister and say to her, this is my now time. There we go, that's right. This is my now time. Every tear that I shed, every heartache that I endured, every broken piece of my life, God orchestrated it for now, because now I'm going to see the marvelous hand and favor of the Lord on my life. Now, y'all may not be radical, maybe just a few of you, but I got a lot of radical girls in my church, but maybe I just got a few radical girls. But I want all the radical girls to jump up. You ain't got nothing to lose. You have nothing to lose. To jump up and shout with a loud voice, say, I am blessed and highly favored. Yes, I am. I may not have a dime in my pocketbook. I may have came to Alfred Street on the bus, but I am blessed and highly favored. Clap your hands and give God glory. Please sit.
Yeah. God has a way of preparing you for what he has for you in life. And what I've learned about God, the preparation is never nice. He doesn't do nice preparations. He doesn't do it nicely. He confuses me and tangles up my mind. And as intelligent as I am, I can't figure him out. When I think I should go left, he demands that I go right. When I think I should tell him off, he tells me to keep my mouth shut. He has a strange way of preparing you for what he wants you to do. The good, the bad, the ugly, the ups, the downs, the ins, the outs, the positives, the negatives, the failures, and the successes. God has orchestrated all of them, baby girl, so that you can get to now. If it had not been for your hurt, you'd still be trying to hang on to somebody that don't want to hang on to you. Let me give a little advice to the young sisters. Don't date everybody that everybody is dating. Since your mama didn't tell you, let me tell you, don't date everybody that everybody is dating. I never dated the popular guy. Because I'm too special. And if you're taking everybody else out, you don't have enough money to take me out. We have to teach our girls that they are diamonds. And the best diamond is not in the showcase. Y'all gonna make me preach hard, but I'm ready for you today. Anybody can buy a diamond in the showcase. Tell the jeweler to take you in the back and open up the vault. You're a diamond in the vault, so you can't afford to fool around with all these in the church. You have to keep yourself set aside. I know that God is a forgiver for those who have fallen. I know that. But we don't celebrate enough the women and the girls who are yet virgins when the Bible says, now unto him. I wish I had about 10 mamas in here. Now unto him who's able to keep you from. This is Esther's plight. She's going to be on display, but it's not her fault. She did not volunteer for the job. Mordecai set her up. You got to be careful because some people are in your life just to set you up. I had a few of them in my life, but you do know I can handle. You do know I can handle it. I had one in my church. Pastor that said, okay, Pastor, can you just tell me what kind of pie Bishop likes? Because I would like to make him a pie. You know, I wanted to go in my pocketbook and say, pow. Now, I didn't have, how much time I got this? I didn't have a real problem with her making the pie. I had a problem with her singling the pie for Bishop. That was the problem. Now, had she said, what kind of pie does Bishop like? Because I would like to bake one for the family.
I might have, would have told her. But I'm not going to give you any information so you can make a better pie than me. I don't think so. That's not going to happen in this life. Nor the one to come. So I politely told her he likes this pie. Don't come for me. I'm not the one. Don't come for me. Do not come for me. Whatever you do, don't come for me. You do know I said it. Don't come for me. All these women I got in my church, are you kidding me? Sometimes it's a setup. So you have to be careful, sisters, who you allow to come in your life. This may be my last time with you for a while, so I have to set you up. You gotta try some people's spirits to make sure they're the right ones to come into your life. Some women have nothing but bleeding heart story, and they use the church as an excuse to bleed. So some people, you have to tell them, stop talking like that. Get yourself together. God has no respect of person. What he does for others, he'll do for you. Just put yourself in the path that you can receive it. So Mordecai sets her up. And for over a year, he prepares her, or she is prepared to meet the king. She's prepared to meet the king. That's why you have to be careful when you say you call to preach. Let me just hit that while I'm here. Well, I don't need an airplane. We drove my Cadillac truck right out there so I can get home all by myself, you know. And if you come for me, I'm going to bring my ghetto girls back over here, and they will take care of everybody up in here. They will take care of everybody up in here. So you better keep smiling at me. Now, just because you gave a good testimony and you have influence with the women, is no indication that you've been called to preach. You can't even read a scripture right. You have not been to any schooling. You've had no classes in homiletics. And here go your excuse. Well, I just know he called me. He called me. When they get called at Calvary, they don't come to me, because I ask too many questions. Bishop don't ask no questions. I'm so sick. Ugh. I have to have information. So, you say he called you. What did he say? He didn't call you up in here. He called Wesley up in here. But what did he tell you to do? Well, I'm just not sure. Well, you need to go back and have another conversation with the Lord. Because everybody the Lord called, he gave instructions. He called Moses. Moses, yes, sir. Go where? Egypt. Why? Tell Pharaoh to let the people go. When he calls with specifics. So if you don't know what he's called you to do, then you sit down till he tell you. Oh, they just won't let me use my gift. Oh, my gift, my gift, they just won't use. We don't have to let you use your gift. The Bible says your gift. Oh, I know y'all get quiet. Let me go over here. This side is better. The Bible says your gift will. Thank you.
Esther was gifted in ways she did not know, but she had to be prepared before she was allowed to use her gift. Whatever your giftings are, sisters and brothers too, there is a stage of preparation and process that you must go through so that when God gets ready to use you, you will not falter or fumble or fickle yourself with the job. So for over a year and a half, she is prepared. She finally reaches the status of queen. Three things, I'm finished. She finally becomes the queen, but she keeps her nationality secret. Now, this ain't one of my points, but it's a good thing for you to write. Sometimes, ladies, you cannot share your secrets with everybody. You can't tell everybody everything that the Lord has told you, because some people are going to use it against you. And some people are going to be jealous because it's you, because they don't think that you should be used in that particular area. But what I love about God is He's sovereign. And He can pick and choose whoever He wants. And He can do it without your validation or affirmation. If He opens the door, then the devil can't close it. And if the devil can't close it, you sure enough can't close it. So she keeps her nationality a secret. Lean over on your neighbor and say, shh. Be quiet. Let the Lord give revelation to the gift of God He has placed within you. If you're taking notes, here's the first observation. Esther is in the palace. Here goes the first one. She's in a wrong place, but she keeps a right attitude. Let me ask the Holy Ghost to cover me right here. She's in a wrong place, but she keeps the right attitude. Some of you women have attitude problems. You are too attitudinal. I don't even know if it's in the dictionary, but it makes sense right here. You just add a toodle. Everybody got to talk to you a certain way. We got to figure out how you are today. Which one are you coming out? Because there's four or five of you up in there, so we just have to wait to see which one are you coming out. You got an attitude problem. Everybody does not have to bow to you. That was Haman's problem. He had an attitude with Mordecai because Mordecai would not honor him. You got to get over that. Get over yourself. Look at another lady and tell her, get over yourself. You're not the best looking woman in Alfred Street Baptist Church. There's always going to be somebody look better than you. So you got to get over that and keep that attitude out of your spiritual life. You got to pray and ask God to give you the right feeling, the right understanding, so you will treat people like you want to be treated. If you want to speak to, if you want people to speak to you, then speak to somebody. If you want people to be nice to you, then be nice to somebody. If you want people to honor you, then honor somebody. It's in the Bible. You reap what you sow. And your attitude sometimes makes you judgmental. Oh, here she come again. Why is she always lead the song? Because she can sing. Simple deduction.
I'm gonna be finished in a minute. Why they never asked me to fry the chicken? Because it's not good. We don't like your chicken. We don't like your chicken. We don't like your potato salad. Got too much mayonnaise in it. We don't like it. Only thing they want me to do is bake the cake. That's good, because you bake a good one. So get down in the kitchen and bake the cake. Too judgmental. The Lord deals with us with mercy and grace. Then why can't we deal with each other with mercy and grace? And know that you're not good at everything, but you are good at something. So take the gift that you're good at and use it for God's glory and your advantage. We shouldn't have to send you a 3-page email because the women are going on retreat. The pastor done got up here and announced it. The girl done talked about it. Some of y'all ain't been on a retreat since they had one. And you have no excuse. But because you're not in charge, then you can't support anybody else. That's an attitude problem. So Esther knew that there would come a time when she would be used. She didn't know when, she didn't know how, she didn't know where, but she knew God had placed her there for a specific time and a specific reason. She's in a wrong place. No Jew had the right to be there. She should not have been married to a heathen king. But God works all things to your advantage and his glory. So you need to know that no matter what you're dealing with, if you stay with God, it's going to work out to your advantage, and you're gonna give God the glory. She was in a wrong place, but she had the right attitude. She was kind and she talked to everybody right. She kept her posture and her position in a right kind of way. Some of y'all can't lead nobody. You can't lead nobody, because the moment we make you in charge, you change. As long as we were calling you sister and Mrs., you were fine. But the moment you got a title, then you went crazy. So that's why we got to keep calling you Mrs. and sister. We can't call you nothing else. Because if we call you anything else, you're going to get too egotistical. That's the easy word. That's a real word. That's a real word. But she was quiet. She was helpful. She was dutiful. She did what she had to do when she had to do it and never revealed who she was. Here goes observation number 2. Sometimes, ladies, you have to consider the consequences but be willing to take a risk. Consider the consequences but be willing to take a risk. She contemplated within herself, it is possible that I may not come out of this thing alive. I've already counted up the cost. It's possible I'm going to lose some friends or be excommunicated out of the clique. But if it means doing what God has call me to do, then I'll take the risk in spite of the consequences. I came to help some lady as we bring this to a close, that sometimes you gotta consider the consequences. There may be a charge for what you're going to do. There may be some discomfort for what you're going to do. There may be some disappointment in the action that you take, but consider it all and take a risk. God never uses anybody that don't put themselves out there. If you want to be used by God, then you better learn how to take a risk. You better learn how to take a licking and keep on ticking. You better learn that greater is he that is in in you than anything that will ever come against you. You got to learn what the Bible says. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, nay, in all of these things, I am more than a conqueror. You got to have the witness within yourself. You got to be satisfied with every decision that you make. Well, maybe I could have made another one, or maybe I should have, do the, could have, would have, but I did it this way, and I'm woman enough to stand on my own two feet, and whatever comes, comes, because God is on my side. I need to know if I got any risk taking women who are going to put their faith forward and take a risk. Stop talking about it, girl, and put some action behind your words. Say it. She considered the consequences, but she took a risk. In other words, sometimes you got to just show up. Just show up. Just show up. They already said the only thing you're going to do is pray. Well, show up and start praying. They already said there's nothing. Every time you talk to her, it's Jesus, 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 Jesus. And absolutely. Because when I get through talking about Jesus, 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 he going to work for me. You can't help me. And I don't know why we talk to people who have less than we have. Why you talk to somebody who has less faith than you have? That always bothered me. Why weak people hang around weak people. Now, if you know she's not spiritual, what are you talking to her about spiritual things? You need to have some woman in your life who's not afraid of your anointing, not afraid of your position, who will tell you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. You need to stop crying and whining and get yourself together and do battle with the devil. I like girls who like to do battle with the devil. She made up her mind. It's likely that I might not get out of here alive. After all, the king has not called for me for 30 days. And according to the Persian custom, if he doesn't call for you, you cannot enter. History said that there were 6 guards, 3 on each side, stationed at the chamber that entered into the king's palace room. And if you walked in and he did not hold out the golden supper, they would sever your head from your body. So sometimes it is risky. I dare you to slap 3 sisters of 5 and tell them sometimes it's risky. Yeah, sometimes it's a little risky. I gotta put my hand in my pocket and throw my pocketbook over my shoulder, but sometimes it's a little risky. It may not turn out just like I want it to, but I'm going to give it my best shot. I'm going to put my faith foot on it, and I'm going to believe that God is going to change this situation and turn everything that's wrong right. Y'all know the story. So she goes into the king. He receives her. And at the end of the story, my, the gallows that Haman had built for Mordecai, he hung on it itself. Isn't it wonderful how the Lord can make the devil hang himself on his own words? That's why I serve the Lord, because can't nobody fix the devil like the Lord. Can't nobody shut the devil's mouth like the Lord. Can't nobody push you forward like the Lord. He can take every weapon that was meant to destroy you. That's why I give him praise and thanks. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, I got some women in here who can think a little bit. It may not be going just right now, but when I think partake of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me. My soul cries out, hallelujah. I give God blessings for saving me. The Lord says, and the Bible says, that she was in a wrong place, but she had the right attitude. She considered the consequences, but she took the risk anyway. And here goes the last point, and I'm going. The Bible said, when Esther and Mordecai realized what God had done, they came together one more time, and Mordecai and Esther said, we need to throw a party. We need to have a celebration. We need to leave it on the archives of Jewish records that when you get in a jam, if you rely on Jesus, he'll bring you out all right. The says that they threw a party, and they sent word all through the province of Susa, put your best clothes on and come over here and let's celebrate it. Now they called it the Feast of the Purim, and the Feast of the Purim was not like the Passover. No lamb was killed, no blood was shed. The Feast of the Purim was not like the Day of Atonement, when two goats were killed and one was set free. The Feast of the Purim was not like the Feast of the Tabernacles, when trumpets were blown and tribes got together. The Feast of the Purim was not like the Feast of Booths, when they brought gifts into the tabernacle and laid them down at the priest's feet. The Feast of the Purim was when they got together and they started dancing and singing over a victory that had already happened. I'm gonna help you girls to go through 2013. I need some women who can have a flashback and think about what happened in 2010. We're gonna praise him in just a minute for a deliverance that we already have. We're not talking about something that's on the way. We're not talking about a miracle that has to come to pass. But we're going to praise him right here for something that he's already done. You're going to leave it on record for your daughter. When you get in trouble, then learn how to praise God. You're going to leave it on record for your granddaughter. When the enemy rushes in like a flood, then learn how to praise God. You're gonna leave it for your sister, for your siblings, for your goddaughter and your grandchildren. This is what I'm gonna leave on record for you, that God will help you to get the job done if you learn how to praise him in spite of what's going wrong. If you learn how to give him the glory in spite of what they said. If you learn how to praise him all by yourself when you think about it. So we're gonna call today the Feast of the Purim. I want all the ladies to stand up. All the ladies, just get up. All the ladies, get up and tell your neighbor, say, excuse me, I'm beginning to have a flashback. Because last year, they found a lump on my breast, but I'm still here. I'm going to have a flashback, because last year, they fired me from their job, but God made a way. I'm having a flashback. When I was in the car accident, I came out alive. I'm going to have a flashback. I'm going to have a flashback. I'm going to praise God. With a flashback praise. This is the next to the last time. Grab your sister by the hand. Shake that hand like you gonna shake it off. And say, give me some room. Cause I'm getting ready to holler. I'm getting ready to scream. I'm getting ready to come out of character. Cause when I think of the goodness Jesus, I gotta do it. I got to do it. they have. Give it all you got. 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 Put it on the record. 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 Say yeah. I got one more and I'm gone. What else they celebrated was they celebrated themselves as a Jewish nation. They celebrated themselves. I need a few women up in here. Ain't nobody celebrated you for a long time. Them ungrateful kids. Them unappreciative people that are in your life that haven't told you thank you. I'm gonna give you 10 more seconds to celebrate yourself, to wrap your arms around yourself and tell yourself, I am blessed and highly favored. Who God says I am. I'm the head and not the tail. I'm first and not last. I need you to celebrate yourself. So look at your sister for the last time and say, listen here, I'm getting ready to show off because I'm the woman for the job. I'm getting ready to show off because I'm the woman for the job. I'm getting ready to celebrate the great I am that's living inside of me. I'm gonna count to three, girls, and give it your best shot. One, two, three. Celebrate yourself. 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 Celebrate. Celebrate! 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 Celebrate it! Celebrate you! Celebrate you! Celebrate you! You are wonderfully! You are wonderfully! You are fearfully made! Yeah! Yeah! You're the woman for the job. Don't allow unfinished any situation or circumstance to make you think bad of yourself. For who knows? You've been called into the kingdom for such a time as this. And if you die, if I perish, then I perish. That's why God let it happen to you and not your sister. Because he knew you could handle it. It would crush you, but it wouldn't break you to pieces. That's why God gave the heavy load to you. Because you're the woman for the job. He knew you'd.